I was a police officer for 23 years,
Mhm.
and for 14 of those years, I worked undercover. And I primarily investigated the organised drug supply. So I was basically trying to catch gangsters who would supply heroin and crack cocaine to sort of inner city areas. And what I would do is I would look to identify people who could be a conduit, who could introduce me to these criminal networks. A lot of problematic heroin users. I mean, most drug counsellors will tell you it's at least two-thirds of problematic heroin users are actually self-medicating for some kind of childhood abuse, either physical or sexual abuse. I would learn this because people open up to me and tell me their life story and, how they got to where they were. There's a woman I met in Northampton who told me, "Yeah, I can do my rattle. I can come off heroin, and I do sometimes, but when I do, I become suicidal because I remember the sexual abuse that I received as a child. So I stay on it." So for her, it was a pragmatic decision to stay on heroin because it kept her alive. I mean, I knew very early on that the war on drugs couldn't be won and that it was daft. There's lots of things along the way which sort of helped me come to that conclusion. But the final straw really was an operation in Brighton. When I did that operation, they had the highest drug debt in the country per capita by some considerable way. And the reason for that is the police there were incredibly unimaginative and they were overusing the tactic. And they were unprofessional and quite obnoxious as well, to be honest. And because they'd overused the tactic, the gangsters had developed a really good defence against it in that they used a single point of contact, they used homeless people. And they would say to them, "If you bring anyone even within sight of me, then we'll kill you." Eventually, it dawned on me that the reason that these people were getting more and more vicious as time went on was down to me. Well, not just me, people like me. You can never reduce the demand by policing. And so the people who supply that demand have to become more and more violent, more and more frightening in order to combat the tactics of police. So policing drugs causes and increases the violence. It was clear then that this couldn't go on, that having observed this situation being caused by police tactics, by the policing of drugs, it occurred to me that I was duty bound actually to be doing the right thing, and that is to make people realise the folly and the danger and the harm that's being caused. My organisation, which is an international organisation, it exists in 20 countries. We advocate the regulation of all drugs. Portugal had a real horrendous situation with enormous amounts of drug deaths. Their drug deaths were higher per capita than in the UK. They brought in decriminalisation, so they made a health-based policy rather than a punitive one. They now have, after only 16 years of that policy, they now have 3 deaths per million. In this country, we have 46 deaths. So they have a fraction of the drug deaths that we do, and they've achieved that just in 16 years. But if you look at Switzerland is a good example. They have heroin-assisted treatment, so they prescribe heroin. Since they've been doing that, their burglary rates have dropped dramatically. Their shoplifting's virtually disappeared. And very interestingly, street prostitution is virtually gone in Switzerland because people have been rescued from sexual exploitation. Also in Switzerland, they have high street drug testing. If you get some pills of ecstasy and you want to know if it is ecstasy or what's in it, drop it off on a Wednesday. By Friday, you know exactly what the results are, so you know what you're taking. They don't have MDMA deaths in Switzerland. Why do people get addicted to drugs? Well, Rat Park is a great example of one theory and one aspect of addiction. Obviously, and a lot of drug policy around the world is still based on the rat experiments which came before that. They still quote the rat in the cage argument that you stick a rat in a cage, you give it water or cocaine or water or heroin, it takes the heroin or cocaine repeatedly till it dies. And this is what our drug policy is based on. Obviously, the experiment in Canada, Rat Park, showed that if you provide everything else the rat needs, it doesn't go for the drug, and in every case, the rat doesn't use it. So, as Johann Hari beautifully says, this shows that people who are addicted to drugs need connection with people. That's an important aspect of it, especially when you talk about heroin. But I think it's worth mentioning that even the United Nations says that it's that 90% of people who use drugs don't have a problematic relationship with them. So it's only the 10% who do. And that's almost the same for every drug. And interestingly, it's the same percentage of people who get addicted to any activity. It's the same for gambling. It's the same for people who have problem gaming, online gaming, which would seem to indicate that it's down to some issue with the person rather than it being a chemical hook. And you know, people go into hospital all the time. They have a broken hip or various injuries, and that they're given dimorphine, heroin, and they don't come out as addicts. It's not the chemical, it's the person. Well, I mean, heroin-assisted treatment in Switzerland, to my mind, doesn't go far enough, because they only actually give it to 10% of the people who use heroin, and they have to have had two failed attempts at other treatment before they get onto it. But it's the 10% who need the help the most, to be fair. Many of the opponents of heroin treatment will say, you know, you can't give people heroin, they'll just keep taking as much as they want. Now, this is an interesting thing, because in Switzerland, they do give them as much as they want. Mm-hmm. They're allowed to decide their own dose.
Mm-hmm.
And so, for the first 6 weeks, and it's almost always 6 to 8 weeks,
mm-hmm.
that people keep increasing their dose day after day, building the tolerance up. But because they've gone into treatment and they're getting this for free and they're not having to look for steal things to pay for it, they're not having to be sexually exploited, and there's space in their life for other things, they get to a point after 6 to 8 weeks and they think, oh, actually, I don't need to keep doing this. And they all reduce their own level, which I think is one of the most important facts or from pieces of evidence from Switzerland that people need to understand, that once you give someone the space and you look after them, then they don't need to keep chasing that high. Unfortunately, the policy at the moment is actually going away from opioid therapies such as methadone, which mm-hmm. does help. It, you know, for some people, it's the best kind of treatment. For some people, but you know, we have to treat people as individuals. Different people need different treatment. At the moment, government policy is about recovery. So the principle that someone must stop taking drugs and get over their addiction, I would say that it's a direct result of that policy that for the past 3 years we've had record increases in drug deaths, and we now have more drug deaths than road deaths in this country for the first time. As soon as you stop treating it as a punitive issue, you can afford all of the therapy and the counselling that you need as a society, because policing drugs is massively expensive, and whatever kind of health intervention is cheaper than policing drugs.